Welcome back, everyone. We're under safety car conditions here in Kyoto. Reason is a flip by the Merida Racing Team. Dominic is now officially out of the booth. He's preparing himself now for the stint to come. Nice move from back of the safety car onto the leader. That's NX Racing company with Nico Maruto. And the safety car is coming in at the end of this lap.
Good news. So yeah, this is going to be quite exciting at the restart because we do have the... Well, actually, will it be exciting? Because the leader, Mariluto, has a car between him and the second place car of Ivanov, Genuine Racing. And then there's another car between Genuine Racing... Oh, no, there isn't. I'm lying. But yeah, the second and third are next to each other, but between first and second there is another car.
The number 6 car. We've had earlier Loris Paternus in the computer as interview guest. They are some racing for fun, so.
Safety car in this lap.
Maybe they take this approach seriously.
No more tire warming? Good old tyre warming. I remember in MOE 2009-2010, or was it 2008-2009, I can't remember, either way, it was 2009, they banned tyre warming because of a unbelievable pile-up at South City. Like, about half the field got destroyed and a car ended up upside down before the race even started just because they were tyre warming.
And then you had that great protest from one of the teams. It was AMT.
Yes,
so protested the entire field apart from themselves, even though they did the most tire warming.
Did they? I didn't know that.
Yes.
That's funny.
One of the highlights of that year.
I hope it wasn't one of the highlights. I think some of the unbelievable racing in the last lap penalty, or last hour penalty in the 24-hour race, is probably one of the highlights. But
right, it was absolutely the restart.
And yes, restart happening right now. Mariluto takes off. It got
green
a very
flag.
Good restart.
Green flag.
And no overtaking before the start finish line. But and that means that the second place car of Ivanov isn't able to overtake the car that is lapped. And now he is able to because he's crossed the start finish line. But he's lost a lot of time to Mariluto. And any chance he had of possibly taking advantage of the restart has been eliminated.
I'll never guess, by the way, who's got another lap's advantage. I think racing.
Wow, they're all by themselves. Again. Further down the field, we have three wide going into turn four, and it is Daskiewicz going up the inside of Mierli, which is Conquest up the inside of the Stig team. But yeah, Mariluto's got away quite nicely. But Ivanov is catching.
Yes, he's attempting to do the one, but that's for sure. I mean, Ivanov's one of the best drivers for getting his tyres up to temperature for a restart. And they're slightly thinner at the moment, of course, than Miralico, as he's further on his stint, so it should be a bit easier for him to catch up to Miralico at the start of the stint.
Merely just got passed by Kresma and almost lost it going through the bridge corner, and there's contact! Kresma gets hit by Sunninen, and Sunninen backs off to allow him to recover, which was good driving. They made contact through the spoon corner. Was that spoon corner? Yeah, that's spoon corner. And yes, he got away with it just about.
Yes, now alongside Mihal, they come down toward the booty chicane. The FZR actually out-muscled, of course, by the XRR down toward the chicane. And ooh, a little bit of braking from there for the XRR, but managed to get the chicane comfortably enough. Lidden now in the back of these two, though. It could be a three-way in a second. And it definitely is going to be. Lydon's trying it and running, thinks better of it, leaves it to these two to battle into the corner. That's quite sensible driving because he's going to get a lovely cut back. You can tell this already. And he's going to look for a double toe along the straight and to blast right past the road. Clever driving from Lydon there as we go down the main straight. He's going wider sooner than of the Core Racing Pro car down the main straight. They come. Double draft for Virus car. He's going to stick back and go for it now. Beautiful. So the F's are left in their wake. It's down to the two X-Rars, down to turn on one. Lydon just ahead, just now must have a slightly lower wing config, and outbreaks Sunninen. A little bit of a squeeze on the way into turn
one,
but he is through into sixth position. Virus making a little bit of a comeback now. I think actually Core are a lap down, looking at it.
Yeah, Core Racing are a lap down. Both of their cars are a lap down.
Shouldn't have been defending that hard then.
So Core Racing, they were obviously one of the big teams back in the day when I was doing lots of commentary on things. Are they still the giant they once were, or have a lot of their drivers moved over to iRacing?
Core Racing basically defuncted in about 2009, I would say. They're still a big team. Oh, Dennis Lynn up inside of me, down into turn number 9. That wasn't going to work, Dennis. Happy birthday, by the way, for 4 minutes' time. Basically, Core Racing have been through the tough times, but they found a new generation of young, Finnish up-and-coming drivers, and they basically, I would say, they're right back up there again. They have had a few good results in the last year, and they're definitely on the comeback trail, I would definitely say. How long it lasts for is how long's a piece of string, really? I mean, how long is LFS development? That's the thing, really, these days, isn't it, for everybody?
They're going to start measuring time in Scirocco years, I think.
Well, we're not even on the...
Oh, contact in the leaders! Merito gets hit up the rear by Ivanov, and that allowed Merito to get away. Ivanov actually lost it quite a bit as they went through the final corner, and Merito gets away with it.
Behind them, Crespo and Lydon are actually side by side as well, coming onto the main straight, over fifth position. Down the main straight, the Compton will have a speed advantage with the XRR naturally, anyway. Pulls out alongside and cruises past for fifth place. The Virus's little comeback is continuing at the moment. Crespo will have to be careful under braking in the draft of Lydon. He is. Careful as you do it.
Now, Pers is. Gadja is trying to unlap himself. I mean, it's pretty hard to unlap yourself with these guys. Yeah, because Hellenic are a lap ahead of all the other people behind them, which is impressive. And but
impressive and frustrating at the same time.
Yeah.
Because I'm sure they quite like before, because they pitted, sort of having got that lap advantage and made sure that they couldn't be caught, sort of thing, around 17 seconds by the car ahead. So, yeah.
Ivanov in second position is just under a second behind Miruluto in the lead and is catching again, and I feel that we will again have battle joined in the next lap.
So I mean, Crassi at the start of this race didn't look comfortable in the setup, but it's like he grew into it as the stints went on. He was absolutely flying before he stuck it in the wall in turn one, unfortunately, when he was just right in the back of the leaders. So now if he can finally get through, finally have that lead that he's been craving, I'm sure, for the whole of this race, then it'll be interesting to see his pace, especially on the slightly considerably thinner tyres than Miralito has just now with the lighter fuel load. He's in the draft right now as they go across the start finish straight. Up alongside he goes. Miralito put no resistance up because he will know, of course, that he is in a far weaker position at this stage of the stint than Krassi Ivanov. Ivanov takes away. Genuine Racing back in front here. Again, the strategy is going to be pretty interesting for the rest of this race. I suspect the Knicks just have it slightly overall on pace, but if they keep on going the way they have for the first 8 hours of this race, involved in many, many incidents and wheel failures and things like that, then it could be interesting to see how Genuine Racing cope with this race. If they remain consistent, they are definitely a big player in the rest of this in the last 16 hours of this race.
Yeah, we're just about to head up to 8 hours gone. In fact, just over a minute until 8 hours is gone, that'll be one third distance. If my maths don't fail me, and they do not, I'm correct. Congrats to me. You know, Ivanov takes off into distance. These top two cars were in a league of their own. They still are in a league of their own after the restart. They clearly have the pace on everyone. The next closest battle behind is... Oh, we've got a bit of contact going on further down the field. With Gadja and
oh woohoo, it's Dennis Lynn's birthday. Ooh, go Dennis. P20th delivery to the man in the car fenty.
We've got a three-way driving here between three of the AM cars. Pers, the lead driver, getting involved in a battle between two cars who are obviously quite a long way down the field. And sort of splits them apart as they go under the bridge corner.
Yeah, I'm sure he's getting quite frustrated by this sort of thing. He'll be thinking, well, we're in the same class as you, so why should we let you through? But you have to. And there's a car in the wall. It's Fernandez. This time is definitely in the wall. 05 on the oval section. Why? How has he got off there?
I'm assuming he must have had contact coming out the spoon.
You'd like to think so. That's a lot of right side damage, Michael, and that'll definitely have to be a pit stop. He's scraping along the wall into the British screen.
Yeah, that is that car is definitely about a little bit 10% thinner than it was before.
Contact between Lynn and Sidia then. So let's have a look, and that is what, 6th, was it?
Birthday beats for Dennis.
Yeah, okay, so Sidia, I think, is actually a lap down on Dennis Lynn. I don't know when they make contact.
Yes, you're right, Sunin is a lap down on Lind. It's really hard to know, especially when you've had a disconnection, that there are people who appear to be behind you who are actually ahead of you. At this point, it gets quite confusing.
Yes, it certainly will be, I think.
That's another thing LFS needs, it needs its own endurance mode that keeps track of things like this.
LFS definitely needs a few things. I think that would definitely be one of the... LFS actually needs its own tracker, to be perfectly honest. It wouldn't be the hardest thing in the world for them to code, I'm sure. But they just... I don't know, it's... Well, we've been round in circles on this topic for many, many years now, and I think that the fact that we're still seeing it in 2013 is amusing.
I've been playing LFS for 7 years now. Scares the life out of me.
Yeah, it's 5 years in April for me. Well, I don't play it anymore.
Yeah, actually, to be fair, I've not played it in, well, properly played it in a number of years, but still, I've had an account for that long.
Yes, I mainly just browse the forums these days. There's not really much to browse there, though. It's a shame. I mean, it was once a great community, I just don't think it is anymore.
So, the new sim on the market, or newish project cars, what is that stolen anyone?
I don't think it has. I think everybody's waiting for Assetto Corsa.
What's that? Tell me about that.
That is Netcar Pro's developers have licenses for tracks, and they've got laser scanning on many, many tracks as well, and yeah.
Is it's going to be good. Is that a subscription game? I think you'd need a lot of cash to do stuff like that.
I think they said it's going to be a one-off payment.
Of £1 million?
No. They've got licenses from BMW and things like that, I think, so... should be quite good. I think they've scanned Imola, actually. I think they've great tracks of Dante or Imola. Just listing says it's a payment. I'm assuming that's, Tito. Or is it Dom? No, it's Dom. Hello, Dom. What is Tito? Yeah, so it's a one-off payment, I'm pretty sure. It's supposed to be going to be really good. So, I think that's going to be the next one that it sort of goes after.
Okay. And iRacing these days, and I mean they're still around, still, I guess their subscriber base is still there, despite...
Still stealing your money for a substandard product.
Ooh, we're going to cause some controversy with that one.
I love Timo even in the afternoon for that one, I think, because he loves iRacing too much these days. I think iRacing is, it's alright, but... For the amount people pay for it, I think that people expect more than alright, to be honest. You used to be subscribed to iRacing, I know. Did you ever think it was anything more than alright?
I had a great time with it. I thought the racing was always really clean. The netcode was brilliant. And that was really the important thing. Like, the online aspect was extremely well done. I thought it was quite good, but it was, yeah, too much money to actually commit to it. And we have a battle going on for third position. Daskovitz is about to be passed by Sean Liddon, who is trying to go around the outside and then to the inside into the final chicane, and he does it successfully. Liddon driving for Vires, Daskovitz for Conquest, but Daskovitz is going to get past him again on this straight because he's so close to the back. Gives him a little bump by accident, needs to get back in the slipstream if he's going to have a chance, and he's bump drafting down the straight. He's to the inside. Now, he'll have to brake pretty late to make this work, and he's not quite close enough. No, he'll try it somewhere else, I think. Pretty good decision.
He might lose out the draft a little bit here. Yes, he will. So he won't be down to turn number 4. If you check the entry box link thing, I've just given it to... I'll give you a look.
Sorry, Chris, I wasn't listening.
If you just check out the commentary box, Mike will give you a link.
I have a link. Ah! A link to Assetto Corsa to educate me on sim racing these days. Well, while I watch this...
to reintroduce Oscar Hardwick.
Yay. I'm back, and roughly an hour earlier than I planned to be back. Hello.
What exactly were you doing?
I was babysitting for my aunt.
Was that exciting?
Not really, but I got paid money. So it was a better offer than Deco gave me.
Sandwiches are not enough. Anyway, you have missed quite a lot.
It does seem that way, although the top sort of like bump seems relatively similar.
Well, yes, it's just everybody keeps on crashing whenever they get near the lead.
But have we still got that curse going on where if you're at the front you will then have a horrendous accident?
Sort of. It just seems to have changed. It's not really crashing anymore. It's just sort of silliness, I suppose. I mean, and it's in the lead, Genuine Racing being in the lead, even though they're slightly shorter runs at the moment. It's quite fascinating. I think those two are starting to make a break for it. We've had two safety car incidents. Five is off somewhere here.
Oh, he's upside down.
I think he managed to get back on his wheels again.
He's back on all fours.
Where the hell is he? Oh, he's in the British. Oh, Ulrich is off in the British game.
Wow, I just saw the, that was, we actually caught that on the stream. We were on board with another driver, and you could see him rolling in the mirror. He fully rolled over, and then ended up back on his wheels again. That was impressive.
I think he actually then got a bit lag-tapped. And the lag itself caused enough of a violent collision for the car to tip over.
It's got no damage.
Not really, no.
That's amazing. There's no damage to a suspension whatsoever.
There looks like there is the tiniest bit of damp damage on the right rear.
Yes, you're right.
That's such a small amount. I mean, that shouldn't really affect anything.
No, car's a bit flatter, more aerodynamic.
I mean, that's impressive that the car can still go in a straight line, let alone has no damage.
Reminds me of an incident last year in the GT2 World Series where I called the caution for a car that was upside down, and then
as Gash has just been tapped off in turn one, I'm going to call that. Got back going again.
We're getting quite action packed here on this lap.
See, I come back and the action just starts up again.
Yes, don't flatter yourself, Oscar.
I wouldn't think that. So, what have I missed since hour three, roughly?
Well, it's not, can't really remember anymore. I took
I've
a
not
two
been,
hour break, so.
Not been keeping notes of what each car has done. But
well, generally, were there any horrendous accidents? Have there been any retirements?
Yes, there have been two safety cars and one retirement.
Who was the retirement?
It was Merida Racing Team. They rolled about half an hour ago.
And Nicky Dacic and Isaac Price had a crash. As well, predictably, 20 minutes before it happened.
Looking at it, I would say that Isaac came off better.
No.
So they're just in confusing positions because.
Oh, there's been safety cars.
Yeah, true. Now I see that both of my team cars are still running, which is a miracle in and of itself.
Yes, you missed Jacob Cooper coming in for an interview.
Has he driven yet?
Yes, he drove the first few sets.
Cooper didn't, did he?
Yes, he did.
I was here and commentating, but I do not remember that. Indeed. Well,
I'm sure this is great for people listening at home, because there's some people talking here privately without talking to the stream, and other people talking to the stream, so you're hearing half a conversation.
Anyway, would you like to wish your team leader a happy birthday, Oscar?
Of course I would. As is always the case, it's nice that Des has, but he was out in Spain recently testing a Lamborghini GT3 car.
It's a hard life.
No. Nice for
some, Trumpus is off again.
Ooh. Back on, he's alright.
Back on. So yeah, I was out in Spain testing a GT3 Lamborghini, and I've heard a good few stories about that and how much fun it was. But no, I'm hoping that actually the Pro Car can get some luck today, because the Pro Car for Infinity has been pretty good so far this season and has just not had a great deal of luck. West Hill, it fell apart sort of midway through, and it was the same story with the other rounds so far this season. It was unreliably performed, although there was a time out for them earlier. It's currently running in fourth. Nothing to complain about there.
Just have a look at the recent lap times of our top drivers. And the leaders are still the fastest. Ivanov was the fastest of the top four with a 2:14.52. Inex were the second fastest with a 2:14.79. And Viros were the third fastest, and Infinity were the fourth. So basically, the leaders are all spreading apart slowly because each one of them is faster than the one ahead, behind. What? Yeah. Words.
Say that, but Linden took about 0.4 out of Lydon, and they are well within touching distance.
They are, well, yes, they're going to have a battle quite soon. Lind.
There's less than a second there, and 0.4 a lap, give or take. That's only going to be one or two more laps until they're trying to pass each other into turn one.
Yeah, indeed, this will be a battle for third position. Vires versus Infinity. Vires the blue car, Infinity green. They were a while back, they were a new team, weren't they? Obviously,
that's the point. When you say a while back?
Which one?
A while back they were new, and now they are not.
Who?
Infinity.
Yes, they're what you might call, or formerly called, Mercury.
Yes, that was it. I was trying to remember, they formed out of the ashes of another team. Or just split apart from another team.
It's none of the Mercury Nitrogen thing anymore.
Okay.
Mercury's just sort of... That was as I was entering LFS, really. So...
No, you weren't. We've all seen the thread from... I posted it all over the place today, Oscar.
No!
Since we've been done, I'm sorry.
Don't do that.
In fact, I should have told Michael. Just to use in the picture.
You could give him the link just to inform him of the running joke that I'm ever and ever more upset by, but my own fault. It's Gazda's causing a yellow, I don't know what that's all about.
Oh, and someone else went off ahead of him as he was coming back on the track. They had to fly off onto the grass. But yes, Gazda in the yellow car causing a yellow flag, so he sort of labelled himself quite nicely there.
I think Gazda and actually the Conquest Am Car in general have had one of those unlucky races so far, not dissimilar to, say, Vortex, where just nothing really has gone their way. It's cruel because, again, the Conquest Am car, the Vortex car, both very, very strong lineups and strong cars, and they've just had no luck so far.
Okay, there you go, Michael, you read this.
Yeah, so I've just been sent the link to a thread.
I'd like to point out, I was 12 then, and now I'm 18. There is...
No, that mathematics does not work.
What?
What? Which thread have you sent?
Oh, no, it was 2008, so that's 5 years, so actually, that is almost right. Mm-hmm. In fact, that could be right.
Almost. I'm bad at maths, so...
You're 19 this year, okay. Well,
so you were 12?
Yes.
13.
12. 13. At the time. 12.
You're 13.
12.
So we're looking at, yes, for those who can't see it, I'm looking at a thread created in January 2008 by our co-commentator here, Oscar Hardwick.
13, you're right.
13. Wow. And it's a mess, frankly. It's the start of a new team, and I'm sure they became a legendary.
Okay, you are in for now because team is empty. We do Rally X, no server at the moment, but there shouldn't be no guest.
Come on, we're not even in the silly hours yet. Actually, reading out the post should not be necessary.
You need 138 or less Blackwood.
Hey, I still struggle with that, I'll have you know.
It's big, that's huge. Yeah, we're still looking at Dennis Lind catching Lydon in the Infinity Esports car. That's Lind in the Infinity Esports car. A team that was new at one point and is now not new anymore. And unfortunately, he made a bit of a mistake into the booby chicane and lost some time. He was really ready to start munching away on the back of Lydon's car, but not anymore.
I think there may have just been a coming together for Cinchetti and Ulrich. I believe Ulrich is a lapped car for Cinchetti in this instance. They had a bit of a come together just before spring curve.
So Lind is gradually working his way back up to the rear of Lydon, and I think he may possibly have an opportunity for a pass as they go into the oval, maybe even before, because Lydon is quite slow out of turn 3, turn 4. Oh, I shouldn't have got that map again, I think. That was turn 4. Well, now we're at like turn 7, so that's irrelevant now. This is going to be the battle for the final podium position. We're 8 hours and 17 minutes in to the 24-hour race.
Oh, Rawlins almost lost it. He got right out on the grass there.
Yeah, we're going to have a pass into Spoon Curve. If he manages it, this will be difficult. So close together, no contact though. Great driving. Lynn showed him his nose, but there's just not enough space on the inside of that corner, and it's not tight enough to really pass through unless you have a big speed differential. But he's going to be in the slipstream as they head towards Beadley Chicane.
Yeah, it's too far back though, I think, so might have to be towards there as Harnanen's timed out for that's the number 60 car.
They were in last place of the current runners. That's a savage SimSports having it. They've had a very difficult race already, and that's going to make it even more.
Here naked. Comes Lynn down the inside. No, not yet.
Very patient. He's playing a long game. He's treating this as an endurance. There's no point in doing a risky move at this point because it's still 16 hours to go.
You should have seen him in the first 60 minutes.
Did he have a bit of an action-packed time?
I think everybody did. I mean, I'm surprised that there have been two yellow flag periods since it's been gone because it had actually calmed down considerably from the early parts of the race.
Lydon has managed to stay ahead quite for the majority of the last lap or so. He's back on a par with Lynn's lap times, but he just has to keep it clean because the reason why Lynn caught him up last lap is because he made a mistake. So he needs to just, well, not, basically.
Well, like you said earlier on, these top four really are just that they're the class, they're the top four class, they're all setting the same lap times when they're not making errors or pushing a bit harder, so in theory, should they keep it on the grey bit, then it wouldn't really be a great deal of catching or moving away.
Yeah, and that's where the other skill means you can be fast, but you've got to be consistent as well and not make those errors every now and then. Lynn had been off earlier in the race as well. He went into the gravel, but managed to get it out again.
And ooh, he's gone sideways there, though.
Yeah, little mistakes, and there you go. Lynn's going to have a really good opportunity to get past.
It's going to happen.
Lynn's car absolutely squirming all over the place as he came out of the corner because of the dirt on his tyres, but that'll probably allow Lynn to get away as the dirt continues to affect Lynn's pace.
As our leader's in the pit lane, or our ex-leader I should say, you now have Mikko Merlioto leading the way for the moment. Krasimir Ivanov, Genuine Racing in the pit lane, who is taking over from him? Robin Heidemann. I don't know if he's actually been out in the car yet, but...
Yeah, he was in earlier.
Robin, obviously well known for, I guess, his endurance racing in LFS and then also his LFS kart endeavours in recent years. Also got, I'm not sure, but I'm guessing that the LLM Amcar is still relatively high up, third or fourth in class. They've made their pit stop as well.
I think LLM... I think it was their car has, yeah, their car has engine damage. Oh, Maluto's been off. Maluto's been off. He's had a crash at the exit of the bridge corner, and he's damaged the right hand side of the car.
I was just on board with Dennis Lynn. He came to view, so
he still leads the race, but by so now yeah. Dennis, yeah. Exactly, as Theo says, Dennis is now going to be fighting for the lead with the damaged Merlioto. And third place is Lydon, so they're all three of them going to be battling for the lead. And Lydon is going to go past Lind.
Well, he's going to try anyway.
Wow.
I think Lynn just held that inside line nicely there, and not a lot Lynn could have done.
So the cars you're seeing here, NX Racing in first position, Infinity Esports in second, and Team Viras in third, and that is after 8 hours and 22 minutes. That's how close they are.
Well, it's a testament to the pace of these teams to have been so fast and so consistent to this point, that after such a long period they can all be nose to tail on the track.
I think Mariluto, I can't pronounce his name properly, I'm absolutely terrible.
Mariluto.
Yes, and we're going to have Lydon going past Lind now as they come into turn one. Who's going to break later? Lydon does break later. Can he get it through the corner? Yes.
Well, that slowed down well. Wouldn't be surprised if Lind now has to go. All of this is actually saving Mariluto and Inex, as these two fight each other as they make a bit of contact. Mariluto can just carry on cruising even with his damage.
Yeah, indeed. He's been given a good opportunity here. He probably would have lost the lead had Lydon not got involved with Lind, but he's able to get used to the damage on the car and just get back into a rhythm again. That's really important. Once you make a mistake, you just have to forget about it and not keep thinking about how bad it was.
Yeah, and another thing is, with the XRRs going as long as they have been going in stints, even with damage, should that make a stint slightly shorter or slightly longer, it doesn't seem to me that that would necessarily make or break anyone's strategy at this stage in the race.
Yeah, indeed. And Mariluto, yeah, he's pulled about a second, maybe a little under a second on Lind, and he's not pulled away as much as he would have liked.
No, but then the damage is, I imagine if he's got the various upright and damper damage that he does have, as Dennis and Lynn had a little lag there, but, and another.
Oh yeah, big lag.
He's gone.
Oh no. He's, 10 second lag so far. It's getting...
That's a goner, so far as I can tell. We've not seen any 10 seconds.
We had Lydon earlier having major problems lagging out for multiple 30 seconds at a time and then reappearing, so we'll
Dennis Lind has already lagged out once this race, and to time out in the final sector you're going to lose a lap near enough.
Yes.
So yeah,
oh,
there you go, he's gone.
No.
So
that's a really big shame, because that was setting up to be a great fight.
It
especially
was,
after recovering from climbing out before as well. That is so frustrating.
It's another mountain to climb for Infinity Esports Pro. Fortunately, not even halfway through this race, so mountains have still got time to be sorted and whatnot, but you gotta think, it's just unlucky, and with Dennis's connection issues today, would it be wise to start putting the other drivers in the car a bit more often?
Yeah, I don't know, I guess they just hoped it was one off, but obviously not. And Kovac, has just connected and come out, and that took quite a while for him to get in the car, because he probably wasn't expecting to have to do that. So that's, yeah, at least, well, more than a lap worth of time lost for Infinity Esports.
Yeah, I think with the way that the grid's spaced out, that should keep them in the top 10 still, just about. But it's not ideal, is it? I mean, to have things like that go wrong for you when you're in such a strong position, right kick in the chin, but...
Or kick in the nose if you're Denver Barr. That's a football reference, so...
Football reference, so completely wasted on myself and the majority of other people here. Well, I guess Chris Ford will understand what you're on about entirely.
It's just when I went out of the commentary booth, the virtual commentary booth, I walked into the kitchen and saw Match of the Day, and the first thing I saw was Denver Barr being kicked in the face. By accident.
Well, sort of fitting, because that's what should happen to literally most footballers.
Wow, okay. Axe to grind.
I don't have an axe to grind.
You have an axe to grind against Denver Barr's face?
No, not specifically. I think it's unfair for me to be picking people out. I'm just not a big football fan.
The best thing about that was that it was Chelsea versus Arsenal. What? No, it wasn't. Chelsea versus Newcastle, and Denver Barr had literally just moved from Newcastle to Chelsea, so it was a...
It was a grudge kick.
Exactly. Well, clearly.
It's what it was.
Yeah. But anyway, enough football talk. The only foot-related things going on here are pedals, I guess. I'm going to, right, we'll give you a rundown of the positions, and we'll just see where Infinity ended up after all that. They're 9th, and they are, oh no, they are 12th, in fact, 10th in class, 12th overall, and they are 2 laps behind, which is frustrating for them, and they are a lap behind the car ahead. I was hoping to announce live on air that I'd just won the lottery, but I haven't. So that's breaking news to you right there. The lottery numbers did not come my way this week.
I can't remember what the chances are of that. I used to be able to tell you you won in X chance for winning the lottery. And
yeah.
I no longer can. It's gone.
That's unfortunate. But yeah, I mean, I guess that's winning the jackpot, but actually winning... I've got a very good track record with the lottery, actually. I think I've played about... I think I'm in a profit, just about. I think I've won £25-30 total in my lottery career. So if I keep going like that, I'll be quitting. So in a moment we're going to have joining us in the commentary booth, we're going to have Dennis Lind, and Dennis Lind has just come in. Hello Dennis.
Hi.
Fix your internet.
Yeah, I should.
What's going on there?
I don't know, there's some construction building really nearby that's near the internet lines apparently, so every time they dig over a cable or disconnect something or drill into something, the vibrations cause that there's a loose wire somewhere that gets disconnected sometimes. Early in the race I had another issue where I received a message from the provider that said that they picked over a cable. So it was a quick fix for them as well. But
I guess the real question is, why are you digging up internet cables at this time of the morning? It's morning for you now, is it not?
It's, well, yeah. It's Polish workers, so they basically work all through the night.
Wonderful.
Yeah, it's cool.
Okay then, so besides from your various internet issues so far this race, how has the actual race gone so far, not just for the Pro Car, but also the AM entry that you are fielding?
Well, I think all in all it's been an okay experience so far. We've had our difficulties, obviously, but to be fair, I think it's been a good race so far, also for the New Dimensions Racing. I think they've done a good job on making it possible to not bring out the safety car every time there was a car stuck in the gravel, so I think it's been a really, really, really good race so far on all aspects.
You were having a really good battle up in second position before you disconnected. Were you having a nice bit of fun there?
I didn't see this one, more like a sweaty night call or something, I don't know. Well, I had a pretty rough time coming through the field. I was pretty much last in the queue. So it was a good bit of fun coming through the field. So it was nice to have some proper racing again.
And it's your birthday right now as well.
Yep, 20 years strong.
20 years strong. Have you got plans for, I'm guessing, this tonight or tomorrow night?
Well, not really. Tomorrow afternoon there'll be some friends and family coming over for some biscuits and coffee and tea and whatever they'd like to put in their mouth.
Dennis.
So it's past midnight. This is normal MOE stuff. We're allowed to talk about stuff like that.
So, and you obviously have real life racing efforts. What are you doing in your real life racing these days? I know you've been driving a Lamborghini recently.
Yeah, we actually tried to fix some plans for that to drive in the British GT. We are getting closer to a conclusion about it. But so far, all that's planned is the Thunder Cup in Denmark, which was Camaro Cup recently. All absolutely. Where I finished second.
Alright, nice. Is racing a side project? It's not your main sort of. It's like, what's the other thing you like to do, but you have other things on the side, like that, to earn you the money to actually go do it?
Yes, as a trainee, I work in a company, which is a consulting engineering company, where I'm a technical designer. So I drill loads of buildings and foundations for buildings and roads and pretty much straight line.
So you're basically like the real life Sim City?
Basically, yeah, that's a good way to put it. It's not as fun though.
No.
But I would call racing my main thing, as the company I work for is also my main sponsor. They pay for everything that's racing related, and also they give me the funds to, you know, live and fitness cards and whatever I needed for racing really. Right. And transport.
That's pretty fantastic then. So yeah, they support you all the way through.
Yes, basically.
So are you looking to sort of, I don't know, is it realistic to think you'd end up doing racing as a full-time thing, or is it really only going to be as it is now, do you think?
After Christmas I am going to do racing full-time if this season goes well. We have plans about Le Mans already for next year. So for now I think we'll just take this season. If I end up with a contract with either Lamborghini or some other GT team, which I don't expect, but it's something that I really want, then I think racing will be a full-time opportunity.
Oh, you're going to live the dream then, basically. A lot of jealous people are going to watch you.
And sexy ladies.
Obviously, yes, that's priority.
I'm just going to watch Dennis cry himself to sleep thinking about how much I wish I was able to do any of that.
Well, you live close to me, also, let's put it that way. Sort of.
Within reason, it's only like a few hundred miles.
Well, who knows, I might move to England this year, but we'll see.
You might move to England?
If I get to race in England, there's no reason to go back and forth to Denmark every few weeks.
It's very true. Feel free to move to England, just as long as it's a reasonable distance away from me, as Sean Lydon nearly spins. And I think the 59, which is...
Did you say Sean Lydon?
Sean Lydon.
Oh, okay.
And also we've had Wojtkowiak, who is actually the Infiniti Sports Am driver, pirouette it on the exit of the fast right-hander under the bridge, which isn't ideal. He's not got too much damage, but the tyres are looking toasty.
also want to give a big shout out to Hellenic Racing, who's been doing a fantastic job in the bus. I can't believe the position that they're in, that it's actually possible to do that on this sort of track. So good job guys.
Doing FXRs proud everywhere, I think.
Well, Hellenic Racing always do. And they're a bunch of FXR specialists, and you do always find that the best that you can get from a car that on long, fast tracks like this is weak, they will make it be weak in the best way possible.
I'm fearing a bit for South City though, because they are going to be faster, without doubt.
It's going to be tough to keep with them, I would say. I mean, maybe some of these new really fast pro cars might edge away, but in terms of the rest of the field, the rest of the AM field, and you know, probably a good half of the pro, I would say you're going to struggle against a team that's quite as good quality as Hellenic driving the FXR.
True, and it's also fair drivers on the track. I mean, I've never had problems with any of them, so yeah, they're doing pretty well, and I hope they'll get some great results coming at them soon. This should be the server.
We were looking at it earlier, they've had a 0 point score in round one, and it doesn't look like they've yet podiumed. I don't know if I got corrected on that, or if anyone does want to correct me on that. It looks like a fourth and a fifth that they got in rounds two and three respectively.
I said decent result, not bad.
But decent. Decent considering West Hill. FXRs aren't fantastic there either. As we've actually got a battle for fourth going on that we should probably pay attention to, side by side between Robin Heidemann and Frankie Cincetti, as Heidemann has made a move going into turn one, and Nicky Dakovic has reconnected. He was connected a bit earlier on, but obviously just got his timings mixed up. Looks like Cincetti might be making a pit stop at the end of this lap. Remember that before pit stops started happening, Ivanov was actually leading overall. So Jenner are net leaders, I believe would be the right term for it, unless Inex have made enough headway.
I think they're a bit out of kilter pit stop wise, aren't they?
They are. I'm not convinced that Genuine Racing have been going quite as far as everyone else on theirs. Either that or they've had a tyre drama whilst I wasn't here.
I'm trying to think back. Nothing's happened. Oh, so Lydon's got a yellow flag.
Yeah, he's looks like he's backed it into the booth he chicane by. He just ran out of grip. So I'm expecting to see Cincetti pit at the end of this lap for Ixie and Sim Sports, which would put Heidemann into fourth, and the other three that would then be in front of him, although a big shout has got to be given for Stick Breeding Program Pro, running in third at the moment. Nice job from them. But I think Heidemann over the next probably 20 minutes or so is going to move his way back up to first. Drama's pending, of course, as Cincetti goes very wide in the last little complex here at Kyoto.
Goes into the pit lane. So, since I've been away from LFS as well, they added a new feature that allows you to kind of open up the track entirely and design your own combinations.
Yeah, mess about with it a bit. Is the sorry, do you carry on?
I was going to say how much is, I know that there was a race on Kyoto a while back with a sort of really super long combination, like this sort of national, international oval, so it was a bit of everything. How much is that getting used? Like, are there any good combinations that have been made using this editor? Yes.
Yeah, there have been a few properly good tracks where we're just thinking, why didn't the devs just do this originally? Because there's been a lot of tracks made that you could almost argue work better than the actual layouts that were put with Liverspeed originally.
Oh, really? Okay. Because I know the one at Kyoto turned the stupid chicane into a hairpin, which was quite cool.
Yeah, well, the booty chicane's been around for eons. Now, that really was the start of fiddling about with combos, because that was before the development team opened up the ability to just use any section of the track for a course.
The only real set down there is about the X courses is that there is a massive frame drop in most of the tracks, especially Fern Bay. That's really, really a problem.
As our leader dives into pit lane now, Miku Maru-Lyoto, and Robin Friscos, I believe, is ready to hop into that car. So Sean Lynn will become our temporary leader. He's doing a good job, but it looks like he's getting a bit of hassle from Suninen. Core Pro 2, that is, in the number 9. Lap down still from this lead bunch, and running in about 9th. I'm not sure that's true, though. Infinity might still be in front of them. 9th to 10th. As we've actually got Hellenic Racing Team in pit lane as well. So yeah. Our AM leader's in as at the moment.
Yeah, they need to come in. Their tyres were looking pretty ropey at best.
And Friscops has come out right behind Hegemon. So, looks like we're going to have a battle for what is currently third position. That is, of course, if Friscops can get himself up to speed with Hegemon, who has been out on track for quite a bit longer. So, should have the pace for the time being.
Yeah, he's got to get those tyres up to temperature. They take quite a while, actually, don't they? These R3s.
Indeed they do, and in the way they're set up as well, all the setups seem to be designed to go for a good chunk over an hour, especially with the XRRs, so... As Sean Lydon enters the pit lane as well, so... current leader pits in, nice pit cycle getting going here, and so is Mihaly for Stig Breeding Program Pro. So Robin Hegemon, I believe, will re-inherit the lead here. Not 100% sure, but he definitely should do.
Yeah, looks like he will. Could be quite close though, or maybe not that close.
Hegemon through, Friscops through, that's gonna be it.
Yeah, third place.
Haley is just. Is he gonna hold on from Schneider's? Yeah, just about, anyway.
Maybe not, actually.
No, could be a very brief holding on.
Yeah, Schneider's, yep, gonna go right past him. Not enough speed for Haley.
I believe that is all of our front runners now have cycled through their current pit stops.
Yeah, Hegemon will probably be in about 20-25 minutes, I suppose.
Yeah, like you say, he is, it seems fairly dramatically out of sync with everybody else.
Yeah, looking at the tracker, they've had... they've had one less pit stop than everyone else, so I'm assuming they had an early pit stop early in the race to fix damage or something of that nature.
It's possible. I'm not sure. Then again, they could have just had any like damage at some point and taken an extra stop for it. Could have just missed it. But it'll be the extra stop to put them out of sync. Hydrogen does indeed start to pull away from Friscott's.
So, Order, Genuine Racing, InX Racing, Team Viras, Stig Breeding Program, and Terra Mind Factory in Pro, Hellenic Racing, further in the lead in the AM class, Stig Breeding in second, last lap third, who we think have engine damage, a little, just a bit of engine damage, fourth is Green Angus, and fifth is Infinity. Oh yeah, if you go listen to 57, see if you can hear any of that popcorn noise. Because I was saying in the chat on the stream that they were losing a few miles an hour on the straight.
I'll watch down the front straight now. I can't hear anything immediate, but I'll have a look at their top speed and then just check it against another XRR. So they managed 264 k's an hour. And if I just find another XRR here, Nicky Dakovich. So if you remember 264. Nicky Dakovich is going to manage 261.
Oh.
So, Ixion actually slower in straight line than LLM Am. I'll do another check on another car. Here we are, I've got a TRR as well. TRR 263. So, I would go as far as to say that they've got no engine damage whatsoever. And
okay.
Stop fretting.
Okay, yeah. I'm assuming, I think it was BMX runs as LLM, isn't he?
Yes.
Yeah,
that's
okay.
Ray Kingsbury, but he's driving their pro car.
Okay.
Their pro car might have engine damage, but I think they would have to have properly mucked it about because that's an FZR.
Yeah, looking at the pro car of LLM, it does seem to be... Well, I've not seen the numbers yet, but it does seem to be losing out a little bit to the core racing machine that just pushed it off.
Well, I was looking there... They could have marginal engine damage. They're about... Maybe they're just braking earlier as well, but it's only 2Ks an hour going through the oval that they're actually down on anyone.
Okay.
So again, I guess if you've had a dodgy downshift, it's something that you're going to think about with lift to speed, but both their cars seem reasonable to me, and they're not having, you know, great gaping losses compared to anyone else on track. Also, Joe Lettarello has just informed me that TRR believe that they might have some engine damage as well. Tell you what, if it makes you sleep better at night, I'll check another XRR down the front stretch.
The engine damage investigation hour.
Indeed. You always get it though, don't you? And it's fair enough. I guess the best one to check would be if I just stick with Kovacs for a while, because that Infinity Pro car is fairly new from shop, seeing as Dennis Lynn timed out not long ago.
Good thinking.
And it's got about 4Ks on the LLM Pro car, which is an FZR, so that's not unreasonable. The XRR should have a little bit more top end.
So you're talking in Ks. I don't understand kilometres per hour. I can never really work out the scale.
I got converted to them a while back by Jarl Tyan, simply because they're more accurate in terms of looking at your apex speeds. So you can actually aim for more specific numbers than with miles per hour.
Yeah, I've noticed everyone seems to be referring to K, so I should probably switch myself over, to be honest. But
very much so. I mean, minus NASCAR now, really, you'll be seeing everything in Ks.
Right, we're now in, I'm now looking at them in kilometres per hour.
One,
so.
Two, three, four. No. So, Team Rock Racing, you don't have engine damage because you're 1K down on a car that's brand new out of the box. And Last Lap Motorsports Am definitely doesn't, because it's doing the same speed as a car that has literally just rejoined from having a timeout. So, obviously a lot of people fretting, thinking, you know, why are we slowing down? I guess everyone will lose a couple of tenths of pace at this sort of time, because you're getting into 9 hours almost into the race. So people that have done stints already are going to be feeling it, feeling the strain on their concentration, and just won't be able to string together quite as good a lap as they've been able to before. And not only that, but with everything calmed down, you're not always focusing on a battle. So it's much easier to just sort of lull yourself into a slower pace than you would normally be doing.
Yeah, if there's no visual landmarks of other cars around, you don't really know what you're doing. Like, you don't know how you're doing in comparison to everyone else at each corner, so, yeah. But yeah, this in this kind of, in LFS, you need to be on the, like, pretty much on it the whole time, because there's no real, you just have to be as fast as you can in endurance races.
Indeed you do. And I believe that as Paso takes himself a wee break, we are rejoined in the commentary box by Stephen Martin.
Hello, Oscar.
Hello, good to see you back in here. I felt for a moment there I was going to be left all high and dry by myself.
No, I wouldn't dream of it.
As you've probably heard, a few people bringing up queries about their engines, which I've kindly checked for them, and they're all just worrying far too much about nothing.
Indeed, but it's the sort of thing that you don't want hanging over your head when you're looking at
over
15 hours remaining in the race.
I had Joe Lettorello messaging me saying that TRR thought that they must have some engine damage because they're about 0.2 seconds a lap slower. But, I mean, there's no engine damage there, it's just the speed of the car is on a par with anyone else in an XRR, so. If you've only lost 0.2 a lap at this stage in a race, I'd be fairly impressed. Looking to see if anyone is particularly close on track, and there are plenty of people in sight of one another, but no one really ready to knock lumps out of another driver.
Indeed, it's one of those quiet spells at the moment, but you know, soon enough there'll be a number of these groups coming together at the same time. That's just how these things work out.
Indeed it is. I'm hoping that when they do get together, they just sort it out quite quickly. Because a sudden bout of hectic for a bunch of dozy drivers could well result in someone upside down. Indeed. So there you are, just as I say, Kovac's making contact with someone or other. Vidal, who may well have been facing the wrong way anyway, looking at how the rear end of his car is shaped up, and oh my god, I don't even want to look at that damage, it's making my eyes hurt. As LLM Pro are scarily close behind Corpro. Gonna have a look going towards turn one, is he? Yes, indeed. For a car that they think has engine damage, it seems to be doing mighty fine. Got it slowed down for turn one nicely. So now we're going to see Core try and get a cut back on them. So they're just about managing.
So the Core car's itself ahead after turn three and going through the sweeping S's now. It's been able to hold on to that place. They're ahead. Oh, and we've got the 57, the LLM XRR, which is second in the AM class. It was just taking a trip on the grass for turn 9, the right hander at the underpass. It only seems to have lost time. It didn't. I don't think it hit anything. Yeah, it seems to be running back to normal. Now only 2.7 seconds ahead of the number 14 Core Pro number 1 car. Which is the next car behind it in the overall standings. Well, of course it's a Pro car, and the next AM car is the 54 Stig Breeding Program car, which is quite a way back, about half a lap further behind, and which runs off the AM podium. Just past the 9 hour mark in this 24 hour race, working green flag lap 233, and it is genuine racing with Robin Heidemann at the wheel, who lead from NX Racing's Robin Friskops and Jean Liddon in the Team Vira's number 2 Pro car. Top three overall are the top three in pro category. I mean, what the leader in the AM category is in seventh overall, it's the Hellenic Racing Team's FXR. Riding to see an FXR so high up in the overall standings.
I apologise for that. I have returned.
Welcome back. The closest battle that I can see on the track at the moment is the 7th overall between the Hellenic Racing Team's FXR and Nicky Nakovic, who is just over
a considerable rate.
Might be just under a second now behind on the track going through the oval section.
Indeed.
I know you guys picked up on it before, but it really is a surprise to me how well this FXR has been running, the Hellenic FXR.
No, we when Dennis was in, we had a conversation about how surprising it is to have a car that is that bad around this track so high up.
Indeed.
Always he makes a little mistake there and he's just going to have to give way.
Yeah, he saw it wasn't really worth fighting that one too hard.
No,
by the time they got side by side.
And with that, we do unfortunately run out of things to talk about for the next 10 minutes. As always seems to be the case, so on to the McLaren launch that was this evening, I believe.
McLaren? I thought that was yesterday.
Possibly. I've been in Wales for a few days, so I'm now very, very far behind everything in the world.
There was the Mercedes one that was meant to be public reveal today, but they had website trouble, I believe. Crashed a website.
Ah.
They wanted people to tweet in with a special hashtag on Twitter for the reveal, so that it reveals more and more of a car on the site as more and more people use the hashtag, but they just crashed a website.
Wonderful. The Ferrari looks nice.
I'm not a fan of the nose. Especially not side on. It doesn't...
I like it, and seeing as my driver team partnership that I was supporting has now parted ways, as a Parnanen for Savage Sim Sports 2 is off in the dirt back on now.
That car's been in all sorts of bother all race, hasn't it? Been in gravel about 4 times, I think. 3 or 4 times, I recall.
4 times, they'll be doing better than Virus. But yes, nice to see some of these F1 cars getting released. It lets you know that the racing season is ready to get back going again. Jonathan Palmer just telling me that the racing season has already started with the Rolex 24. And I was referring more to the F1 and when everything really kicks off and you get weekend after weekend of action.
Well, World Endurance Championship, 14th of April, that's when it starts. All the proper racing. Or Sebring in the middle of March.
Interestingly, I think I'm going to the World Endurance Championship at Silverstone, or possibly will be, at the moment.
Yeah, I expect I will be.
It's your kind of thing, isn't it, Steve?
Just a tad, yes.
Are you not one of the few that go to, well, I say few, one of the many hundred thousands that go to Le Mans every year?
One of the quarter of a million that go to Le Mans. That's a few.
I've been reading around that you might be the lucky owner of an Indianapolis 500 ticket.
That is correct.
I imagine you're looking forward to that one quite a lot.
Yeah, also correct.
So, either you're in lots of debt or just don't eat.
Or
incredibly
yes.
Rich. I can't write that on.
For both, in a sense. But it's student debt, so does it count?
It's student loan, so... It's Speaking of student loan, that's why I was in Swansea. I was looking around at university. As I'm sure Jack Sedgwick will be delighted to hear. And what was quite nice is they told me I was too clever for the course that Jack Sedgwick's on. Yeah.
Was it a course in how to roll race cars?
Well, no, it's motorsport and motorsport engineering and design. And I didn't enter that. No, I did. I entered that for a foundation year, so you basically needed 2 E's at A level. And they changed my application through UCAS to be the proper course because they said that I wasn't stupid enough for the foundation year. Apologize, Timo. At least I'm being mean to him.
Robin Heiserman has been eking out the lead bit by bit. It's now just under 8 seconds to Robin Friskops, although they are on different pit cycles. Not sure, do you recall when Genuine last pitted?
Not precisely, but looking at their tyres, roughly 40 minutes ago.
Yeah, they've still got quite a fair amount of life left in them.
They do indeed. Another thing worth asking, Steve, is I've not actually seen you do a great deal of sim racing yourself very recently.
Yes, there's been a number of. I mean, I did the full LFS Cup season in the summer, which is my last
true
full season on Live for Speed. This summer for me will be quite a bit quieter. I'll do some LFS Cup, but the go to 500 I won't be able to do because I'm in Le Mans for qualifying weekend. Which I moaned very much to Deco about, but he wouldn't
budge.
He
said, get over it, at least you get to go to Le Mans.
Effectively.
Presumably.
And the Kyoto 250, which I've been to the last 4 of.
Yeah.
I'm looking at my wrist in a cast now and thinking that the race is in at the end of next month. I'm thinking that might not happen. But see.
Yeah. Oh, Kyoto 250 is another one for me that I'm always keen to do. Because I hate it every time I do it, but I'll keep coming back to have another go.
Yeah. Well, I really want to come back and have another go at both the races because in the 250 last year I got hit and rolled at the end of turn one. In the 500 I rolled. I've been hit in the aftermath of an accident at the end of lap 3.
Yeah.
But it wasn't
you
a great.
Have any luck when it comes to races. The ovals, do you?
Sorry?
You don't have much luck when it comes to the ovals.
No, I didn't that time.
Yeah, well, the thing with the Kyoto 250 is I want to keep going back because I always seem to be very much at the front, and then get knocked around or lose a lap or something or other. And that's mainly due to Kenneth O'Keefe being a talentless oaf. But, you know, there's a very good chance that he won't bother turning up this year, and then everyone can have some fun. And the Kyoto 500, I think I lead and then fall back and then time out. Always. In 2010, I led it and timed out. I timed out from the lead then. 2011, I didn't lead it, but I did time out with everybody on Virgin Broadband, I think it was. Can't remember if that was 10 or 11. 11 or 12, rather. Might have been 2012.
I think that 2011 some... rings a bell for a load of...
Yeah, it must have been 2012 and I didn't do 11. But then, of course, okay. The Kyoto 150, which is the one event that NDR should bring back. Hope you're listening, Deco. Kyoto 150 was fantastic. And I came second in that, which was a surprise. Our current second place man beat me to the line. Right, so back to the race at hand, and I've been kindly informed of a couple of, well, I say a couple of various different infringements on the rules and results of the protest thread. So we are going to be getting a drive-through for car number 5 for ignoring yellow flags. That is the Last Lap Motorsports Pro entry. So ignoring yellow flags and also causing an avoidable incident. 55 and others are slowed due to an accident, and the number 5 seems to have gone through them all physically and metaphorically. Also, we've got car 7, blah, 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 blah. Warning to car 7 for avoidable contact, and a drive through to car 57 for advancing position whilst cutting the course. So, whilst I flip back to see who those are, so it's Ixion with the warning, and both LLM teams getting the drive-throughs, their pro entry and their am entry there, both times for avoidable contact. So not an ideal 10 minutes to be in that team. Have you ever, Stephen Martin, considered venturing into the world of endurance racing in other sims, dare I say it, on a Live for Speed stream?
Well, I've been competing.
I seem to remember that I've driven with you.
Yes.
In an R-Factor racer. Where you did substantially better than I did, because I'd never driven an endurance race in R-Factor before.
Yes, the endurance racing on there, it was single driver cars, so races only went up to about 2.5 hours at longest, so it depends how you define endurance.
It's an endurance stint.
Indeed. But I've done for 3 seasons now, but aside from that, no, I haven't been up to much in terms of endurance racing on other sims. Or on this sim, to be honest.
I keep meaning to do more LFS, and then it's sort of a case of with Infinity there. With Live for Speed, you need to literally dedicate yourself to it for a number of weeks to be good enough to enter events like this. As there's been a bit of contact, I'm going to see if that resulted in anything smelly. No, it didn't. You need to put so much time to LFS to be anywhere half decent, and it's time that I just tend not to have that much of, or at least not much of it that I want to spend sitting on LFS getting frustrated at how rubbish the cars feel. But, I've done some historic endurance racing away from Everspeed recently, but that's it. Not a lot else. Did the iRacing 2.4 hours of Daytona, which was fun, and I drove well, but went horribly. As the number 11, which is Conquest, has just made a pit stop and driver change. So we've got, I believe it's Pieter Goik, taken over from Jaskovic as Dominic Angle joins the server to take over from our current race leader. So to answer your question, when will Genuine Racing be pitting next lap?
Thank you for the prompt answer there.
I know, only roughly 20 minutes after you asked. I imagine the big question for yourself, who will you be supporting at Le Mans this year?
In terms of...
Well, go on, go through the classes, should you have preferences in any and all of them.
Well, in terms of the guys up front. But in terms of the top prototype drivers, teams, I'm a big Adam McNish, Tom Christensen fan, so that number two car will get my support, but it would be nice to see
someone that's not Audi win.
Yeah. I've never seen DK McNish win in person, but which I'd like to see. But then again, Toyota seems to have a very solid program. I got some very nice drivers who I like quite a lot, especially Alex Wurz. So I'm not too fussed by that. When it comes to the GTs, Masterminds, I hope that they can get that GT.
It's a social name, but I am the proud owner of an Aston Martin Racing Team T-shirt.
Ah, I've got a polo shirt.
You've got the polo. Ooh, splashing out. But no, at just on the breakaway now, we've got Robin Heidemann coming into the pit lane to hand the car over to Dominic Engel, and also Nathan Lamothe has joined, and that's for the 57 car, the LLM AM car, as
Heisman missed his pit box.
Also, I believe I've been informed that the drive-through that was given to the 57 is currently revoked because it's being re-reviewed, as the team brought it up as an issue for them. No doubt Deco will either yay or nay what I've just said, eventually. Apparently I'm right, I've said that right, so that's a fact about a thing. So currently Friskop's our leader, but then with Genuine Racing being a bit off sync, they tend to re-emerge with the lead again, various fatalities and mishaps permitted. So moving back to Le Mans, have this year Aston Martin Racing moved to the V12 Vantage, or are they still
no,
V8 this year?
The V8.
So I'm sure I heard somewhere about them moving to a V12, but
the what that might be is that the GT3 version of the Vantage runs a V12 engine.
Ah, well, that
whereas
would make more sense.
Whereas the GT2 or GTE version runs V8.
And then, also, not just Le Mans itself and Formula One season, got things like Grand Am going on, and that will be interesting as ever. NASCAR starting soon for those that are interested, and of course V8 Supercars. I'm cautiously optimistic to see what Casey Stoner can do in the, I think it's Fujitsu series that is entered in with AAA.
It's now Dunlop series.
It's now Dunlop series. There you go. Shows.
Although that was news to me quite recently as well.
Shows what I know. I always refer to it as the Fujitsu series because that seems to be in my recent memory what it always was. Yeah. But I'm cautiously optimistic to see how he can do because he's obviously very talented on two wheels. But I'm not sure what's going to happen if you give him four.
Yeah, I see. I think he's tried to keep expectations in check lately, after the announcement was made. But I guess it's natural when you're switching codes like that.
True. And another thing with Casey Stoner is he's likely to do that and be calculated about it because he's quite a boring Australian, as Australians go.
I'm not sure there is such a thing as a boring Australian.
And Casey Stoner is it.
I've never been a fan of his. He has quite a big mouth, as he's shown if you've seen press reports of him just having a moan at MotoGP, saying it's just full of puppets and. I'm quite glad MotoGP is rid of him, to be frank.
The thing with motorbikes is it's very much a culture in and of itself, so you get much bigger personalities, in my opinion, when watching your superbikes or your MotoGP and whatnot. So, he didn't really fit for me. He didn't have the exuberance of someone like Rossi or Biaggi, and no one really likes Biaggi either, but he's very, very entertaining and loud and flamboyant, yeah. So...
As is Lorenzo.
As is Lorenzo. I mean,
when you win a race and you jump into a pond or whatever it was, did at Jerez, I think.
I believe so. It will have been one of the Spanish races for Lorenzo.
Well, they're all Spanish races. It's MotoGP.
They're all Spanish races because it's MotoGP and only Spanish people are in it.
Yeah, I mean, this season, MotoGP, there's 274. Grand Prix in Spain.
274.
That's
gone down.
I might be exaggerating slightly. Perfect.
But in all fairness, you look at MotoGP, and you've got to think pre-season favourites for winning anything are all Spaniards, really. I know that Rossi, obviously, moving back to Yamaha, gonna be some promise there. But you've got to think big three are most likely Lorenzo, Pedrosa, and now of course Marc Marquez, who has moved up to the top formula.
Indeed, and it'll be interesting to see how Marquez gets on in the top class.
Yes, as the 05 car, the LLM Pro, has been off again and added small amounts of damper damage to go with.
Oh, and there's the 72.
Yeah, Fernando's gone as well. Added some little damper damage to go with his bent in roof. But back to Marquez. His first year in Moto 2, he was quick but he fell off all the time, and that's why Stefan Bradl ended up winning it, really. Of course, Bradl's very, very talented in his own right, but Marc Marquez was a quicker lap after lap rider, so I'm guessing he'll probably spend most of this year on his backside. And most of next year trying to win the championship. Thank you. So yes, all things considered, quite an interesting year lined up in terms of motorsport.
Indeed.
I'll certainly be watching plenty of it. Hopefully doing a fair amount of driving in the sims myself. Particularly if something like Assetto Corsa comes out any time in the next millennia.
Do you have any plans in place for Lift for Speed racing this year? Do you have your eye on anything?
Well, I'm definitely going to be putting my name down for your usual big events, your Kyoto 500, 250 and whatnot. I'm keen on doing a bit of LFS kart again. So, yeah, I would like to be involved with that from the offset and get myself going. Hopefully Infinity will have some backed entries, one or two teams if possible. I don't know how many of them are going to be interested in driving open wheelers. But I've got a decent track history with the F08. I'd be even more interested if LFS Kart Lite returned, because that was always a personal favourite of mine. Nothing apart from that, really. I'm doing a lot of, like I say, historic racing in R-Factor at the moment, which I'm ever so slowly getting to grips with. Last 2 weeks have produced a win and a third, so it's been going fairly well.
And what sort of cars in particular?
Well, the third place was a Group C race in Nürburgring. GP track, the old 90s GP track. Pulled that off in a 962C.
I'm not jealous. Match.
It was a very fun race, although I got told off for aggressive driving. That was mainly because the back markers weren't particularly obedient, and I got frustrated. And then I had a multi-class race in 1970s touring cars at the 1970s Nordschleife last week, where I won my class in a Chevrolet Camaro.
Not a bad result then.
No, it wasn't, and yeah, that's been very enjoyable. I prefer the older cars just because there's a lot less necessity for accuracy, which I've always struggled with, and it's much more a case of manhandling the thing around. And take these guys in Lift for Speed at the moment, they need to hit the same points every lap. You know, lap after lap, corner after corner, to be getting the consistent lap times that they are, and I'm just near on incapable of doing that anywhere near as well. I suppose it's why I'm decent in things like the F08, simply because it's a bit more slidey and lends itself to being thrown around, whereas these things, you just need the accuracy element. And they're a bit too heavy for me. Still dabble in iRacing as well. Don't know how many people from Lift for Speed do that themselves. I'll be doing the Daytona 500 with them whenever they put that on. I don't really know why I do it. I just enjoy pain, obviously. But, 2.4 hours was great fun, which I was surprised by. I didn't really do any practice and entered in the McLaren. Which is, that's a good car. It's a nice release from iRacing. It'd be nice if they could release the Lotus 49 as well, but it's a good car. Might do some league racing, not the actual iRacing championship, but some league racing in that, in iRacing in the near future as well. I know that that's definitely something in the works with our team, and probably a few others as well. Speaking of our team, Kovacs Ford Esports Pro in the pit lane now, and it looks to me like he's going to be making this one a double stint at least, for himself.
And meanwhile, we've got a fight for fifth, Nicky Dakovic has been reeling in Dominic Engle hand over fist, and it could even be having a look into turn one.
Yeah, he's got the draft, hasn't he? Straight round. Not a problem for Nicky Dakovic just then. No doubt Domi will try and fight back though.
Which he does. And takes a look up the inside. Very close to contact. Still side by side. Definitely
making contact there. I think Nicky's going to have this now if he can just stick himself where Domi's front end is meant to be gripping through these next few corners. He should start to pull away.
And Dominic could come under pressure from the Hellenic, the AM leader, if
possibility
going like this.
Of course, the problem is for Engel at the moment that his tyres are brand new and therefore not quite as quick as these guys who are on much older tyres.
And who have more fuel on board because he's stopped more recently.
That too, as we've got Kresmarin to take over from our current third position car, which I believe is Terra Mind Factory. Dakovic spitting tyres. Just another worthwhile point, if anybody still watching the stream at this time has any questions for myself or Stephen or even the race control, I might be able to patch one or two questions through to them about generalised things to do with this race or sim racing in general, or even real world racing, seeing as we've been touching on that as well. Send them through the various threads. I imagine there'll be one or two on the LFS forum directly relevant to this stream in the GT1 World Series, or you can find me on Twitter at Oscar Hardwick. I don't know if Steve himself is willing to give his Twitter account about.
Sure. I am at Safety Car Steve.
I'll just open these bits and bobs up at the moment and have a look at what's going on.
Couple of pit stoppers at the moment, and number 5506 AM car is in, as is the number 71 Scuderia Gas AM car. And also in, as predicted, is the Terra Mind Factory number 15 Pro car, which was in
Schneider's handing over to Kresma.
And he'll come out in fourth place in category and overall, but he's got the Dakovic and Engel fast approaching. He should be able to hold on to fourth for now at least.
Yeah, there's been some major time loss there then for Genuine Racing, because they were ahead of them last time after this sort of sinking of pit stops, and now they've fallen back, so...
I think the real barometer of what the change has been will be when NX makes their next pit stop, because they were very close after the last stops.
Yeah.
Meanwhile... What? Sorry, carry on.
Right, NX and Vires are relatively close together as we've got them. Is that a lagger? Maybe. Yeah, someone's trying to lag out. Not sure who. I'm just going to tap through the entire field until I find someone. No one. It's sorted itself. No, the front three are relatively close together. I wouldn't be surprised if Friskops has actually got enough gap on people like Dakovic and Engel to make a pit stop and retain the lead. Infinity Lot have put up a rather entertaining video of attempting to wish Dennis happy birthday. That's on the general discussion for this round on the LFS forum, should you be interested in facepalming so hard you hurt yourself. No one really very close on track at the moment.
Well, there's the 4th, 5th and 6th. Fairly close. They've got Dakovic closing on Kresma slightly.
Yeah, well, he can get Kresma, that's a good point.
Dakovic pits. From 5th place. It looks like he's going to stay in the car for another stint. Thank you. Dakovic has come out of the pit. He's behind the
Corpo. They're doing well, considering how awful their first couple of rounds were.
Hitting some time by, presumably. Well, has entered the server.
Indeed. Looking at his tyres, I believe it's only 2 to 3 laps before we see our leader make a pit stop. Roughly the same for Sean Lydon in second. Isaac Price for NX and James Peace for Vira has both joined the server, ready for their respective teams to pit in at the end of this lap. As Anton stops for Falk to take over the Core Racing Pro 2 car, please change that name, it's awful. It's Core Racing Biscuits or Core Racing Lilac or something. I don't care, it's not Core Racing Pro 1, Core Racing Pro 2, because it's difficult and it's nasty. In fact, that should be a thing. From now to the end of the race, the best suggestions for new names for the core teams, just the last little prefix, the best suggestion will get, I don't know, told how brilliant they are briefly before the LFS forum no doubt tells them how rubbish they actually are. But welcome to suggestions, because I'm really bored of core racing teams and having to say their name every time they come up on stream. As Anton does disconnect now, so foul underway. Friskop's coming through the final sector, should be diving for pit lane this time to hand the car over. To Isaac Price, who I believe was in earlier but got a bit unlucky in his stint.
I recall he had coming together with Dakovic, as you'd expect, really, into turn one. Neither came off particularly well, but not terribly either. But it could have been smoother, yeah.
A bit of a accident for Lydon, and Vira's entering the pit lane apparently. Had a little clout with the wall. Looked like NX are actually going to hold the lead entirely here. Indeed, they are. There you go, that's spread out under half. And they had a pit stop in hand.
Indeed,
fantastic job there.
Number 21 car is in as well. From third place. And the gap between Inex and Vira's before the stop was about 12 seconds, and they are still running 1-2, so That is roughly your lead gap at present.
Yeah. Well, moving close together now are Kresma and Dominic Engel. Dominic Engel looking to start making moves.
Indeed, he's taken 3.5 temps out of Kresma that last time by.
See if he's going to make a move any time soon.
Opportunity here for Engel to get a run to the oval section.
Looking good for him here.
Lily's just got to time this right. Pulls ahead, but Kresma knows what he's doing. He's going to try and get slipstream back ahead, but
he should have pulled him out sooner to do that, if that was his plan.
A bit reminiscent of LFS Cup 2011.
The old Tiger Tail final round.
Exactly. That time, Jan Tiger managed to make that sort of move work, but not on this occasion for Kresma.
No, although he should have the run down the main straight here.
I'm not sure he's got the draft. No, Dom's pulling away. But Dominic Engel holds on to first place overall after taking it earlier in the lap. See if he can pull away and show that he really did have the pace over Kresma.
Right then, so now that there's been a little bit of sorting out done on track there, we're going to invite, I believe once again, to the commentary box, Jacob Cooper of Infinity Esports Amateur. Hello, Jake.
Hello.
So it's been a while since you've been in the car, but how is it going as a team effort at the moment for both the cars that Infinity have got entered?
As a team effort, I think everybody that's been in the car has been outstanding, and in a way it's gone better than expected. We had a bit of trouble with the last safety car that came out. We were one of the first cars to be picked up behind the leaders, so in a sense we lost the lap, but Oviatt that's in the car now has been putting in some quite consistent pace, so been able to close some of that deficit now.
Indeed, and the race in itself between, say, you know, your lap traffic and your faster cars coming through, how's that been? Relatively fair so far?
To be fair, every car that's been a lap down that I passed personally has been, you know, no trouble at all, which has been quite surprising, to be honest. Because normally, I mean, in endurance racing, there's an amount that a lap car can sort of hold its ground before it's forced to yield the position. So you're expecting always to fight a bit more than you would in a shorter race or a sprint race.
Very true. Now, when are you next planning on sitting your butt
behind the wheel?
In about half an hour.
It's a good point, actually. It looks like everyone is running long stints today.
I think it's very odd that some of the teams are only running an hour each for each driver, you know, alternating every hour. I think I find that a bit strange, to be honest, because I think you can gain more time out of each driver if they're in two stints.
I mean, we've seen the XRR, the pro car for Infiniti, went particularly long on the very first stint of the race.
Well, Dennis, he's just got a handle on that set and he's able to, wring the neck of the car, but not the tyres.
Yeah, he got an hour and 12 out of it, I believe.
Yeah, just a shame, damn shame about the time out, because he was looking good for taking the lead for a couple of laps. Yeah.
Well, the first time out, you got relatively lucky, because it was early on in the lap, but that second one, you're in the third sector, so obviously you have effectively lost a lap there.
Yeah, well, we've got a Hungarian entourage there in the pro car, and every one of them are very, very talented. I see Hungary myself as a, with all due respect, a poorer version of Finland. They have a lot of talent. I mean, well, there's a lot in the grid right now. I mean,
the whole grid for this race is very well represented, and with Live for Speed, as soon as you're entering any top-level competition, it's going to be well represented. I mean, they've still got pre-qualifying to get into these sort of things.
Indeed, and in the first part of the season, that was a struggling point for us as the AM car. But after Fern Bay, we've just come on loops and bounds. We were unlucky via my mistake at Westhill, got a drive through. I made a mistake on the final corner. I got a drive through because I sped in the pit lane. But if that hadn't happened, we would have finished a lot higher up. But I mean, we're looking good. We're in the top five. It's a double points round. It's going to be really, really good for our championship if we finish where we are. And the pace that Seb's got, it could well mean that we're fourth in class by the time he hands the car over to me.
Yeah, well, that would be nice. Another thing to bear in mind is we're heading for the 10th hour, so we're not even at the 50% mark at the moment.
I know, it's crazy, isn't it? The amount of action that's been going on. I mean, even when you're running on your own, you take a glance at the track map every now and again, you can see there's just cars battling on the, cars on the same lap battling. It's epic. It's been a really good race.
As us commentators like to just refer to it as people crashing into each other every now and then.
Indeed.
Yeah, which seems to be the case with the new InSim, which is informing us of every contact and spill and this, that and the other that goes on.
Yeah, that almost got a bit sketchy in the first stint in our car. I was driving, coming into the booth as you came, with two LLM cars either side.
Yeah, I saw it, a nice three wide move, and they both, forgive me for saying it, but went for the sensible option of slowing down, whereas continued for the corner.
It was one of those moments, and I'm sure you because you sim race quite a lot yourself, there's those moments sometimes where you back out, and there's those moments where you just think, nope, not happening today.
There are those moments where you put your Camaro sideways across every corner for a lap just because you know that you're going to pull away on the straight at Nordschleife.
Indeed.
Yeah. Tell you what, you specifically should try and find yourself a replay of that race.
I should.
And also, the challenge still stands to everyone to beat the laps that are set in that car.
Although, to be fair, I think our friend John, he did a really good job.
Fantastic. I don't know if he's listening at the moment, but genuinely good job from someone who has only been sim racing since November in any competitive format whatsoever.
It's amazing. When he first started, he was using a PS3 controller with a hack drive, like a driver that was hacked, so he used a PS3 controller on the computer. And he was obviously dire with that, but that's because he was on control. When he first got a wheel, he was using way too much steering input, obviously coming from a console line of field, that's, you know, that's kind of the mentality that you have. You just full stick it everywhere. And yeah, in the last, well, to be precise, in the last couple of months, he's got massively yeah, more confident. And
we had the Bathurst race.
That was a baptism of fire for him. That was like his first competitive race.
A bit of a one. Let's do the Bathurst 1000 in cars from the 80s. Oh yeah, by the way, I picked that silly powerful Holden that weighs 2 ton. Yeah.
It was fun.
I mean, as you expect, we all actually made mistakes at being a proper endurance endeavour into our factor. But then about a month after that, me and John did another endurance race in the same set of cars and finished third.
Yeah.
I don't know how much of it you saw. For me, that was probably the best race that I've done in a good couple of years still.
It was awesome. I mean, it's just like this race. I mean, it's that fine balance between absolutely going for it, wheels just touching the grass, edge of the track stuff, and just taking your time and thinking to yourself, it's all about consistency. I mean, racing is really just about consistency. There's no point being quick if you're only quick for one lap.
Indeed.
But in endurance racing, it pretty much every skill in your racecraft is tested, every single skill, and that's what makes it awesome.
Sorry to cut you off, it looks like we've got the LLM Pro cars just had a spin in the final little complex and picked up a little more damage, so he's going to head for the pit lane now. I don't think he really needed to, but that's the decision that's been made there.
It's not very uncommon to see the LLM cars looking a bit worse for wear, though, let's be honest.
In all fairness, they've been doing a good job today, and they're still beating you in AM.
Their AM car has been fantastic today. They've blown my mind, let's be honest. I think they've blown everyone's mind. Don't think anyone expected them to be so quick. But, you know, respect to them, and a massive amount of respect from me to Hellenic Racing. I mean, they got lucky with the safety car, but they are hauling that FX. I don't even know how they can be that fast, but they are.
Well, they're currently on what look to be pretty new tyres, because they're still going through heat peak. But I mean, they're setting times that I couldn't dream of setting in an FZR.
I know, they're setting quicker times than I'm able to do in the FZ. It's crazy.
The FZR that really is as strong a car as anything else around here.
The FZ, compared to the XR, is probably faster in the final sector, but that's where the FXR is strongest of all the cars, is in the final sector.
Indeed it is. Anyway, Mr. Cooper, thank you very much for your time.
Well, what are you...
We're going to get rid of you because you're only in fifth, and hopefully get in a member of Hellenic Racing Team so we can talk to one of the guys that have been leading the AM class for the past couple of hours.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. It'd be nice to hear some Greek accent.
Indeed it was. Thank you very much for joining us, giving a bit of insight into your race so far and a bit of other sim racing that's been going on.
Yeah, keep up the good work.
We'll get rid of you and then pull in another interviewee. Now, I've gone and done that a bit prematurely. So, back to the racing, it would seem, for a few moments, as we've got Roland Lawser facing backwards in the Savage Sim Sports number one car, the Savage Sim Sports car that's not doing great, but it's doing better than the other one. As I believe that Gashter is going to be racing Orza for position. No, not for position. My mistake. So, Steve, can you see anything going on that I'm missing?
Not at the moment.
So, I believe that we've had our current cycle of pit stops go through. We've got Isaac Price still leading in Pro. But in next, I say still leading, I believe he's actually managed to grab that off of Genuine Racing since the last stint that they all completed. James Peace driving for Vires Pro in second, with Dominic Engel, Genuine Racing, rounding out the current podium for lead Pro class. In the amateur class, unbelievably, still have got Hellenic Racing Team in that FXR, pulling themselves around the track in a fashion that no one can quite believe. Hold on whilst I muller a name or two here. Kudarakis is currently driving that car. Second position in the AM class is Nathan Lamoth in the LLM AM entry. Again, fantastic job from them, sort of come from nowhere in the last few races. I believe that it's the Stig Breeding Program amateur car that is currently in third, and that is Borsos currently driving that. They've had an incredibly quiet race. I don't think I've actually spoken about them up until now. So, remarkably uneventful for them, and it's obviously paying off. They're running in third by a fairly healthy margin. Okay then, so finally we are joined in the commentary box by a member of Hellenic Racing Team, Panaulas, and I imagine I've said that horribly wrong. Hello.
That's okay, I don't mind, I get that all the time. Hi, how are you doing?
Yeah, not too bad, and yourself, I imagine you're doing quite well at the moment.
Yes, we're having a blast, I hope it stays that way.
Well, you've got a more than healthy lead. I see. Yeah.
We've been lucky with safety cars. Both the times the safety car practically came out right behind us with the leader. The safety car was between the leader and us, so we got some good clean air and used the time for pit stops, fixing damage, all that.
In fact, you're coming up to lap second place in AM at the moment.
Is that a fact? I didn't even realise.
No, it is. You're about 6-7 seconds behind the LLM amateur car. It's just the Corpro 1 car that's in between you both.
Yeah, looking good. I haven't seen the pit stops though, I don't know. I think we started our stint like 20 minutes ago, and I don't know what kind of stint they're on.
57 pitted fairly recently, within the last 30 minutes, I believe. Yeah, looking at his tyres, that's about right.
And it's been really a clean race until now. Everybody's been very nice, no dive bombings from pro cars, like sometimes.
Yeah, well, how on earth could a pro car dive bomb FXR?
They can.
They can.
Trust me, it happens.
Well, it's impressive because you are minus on the exit of slow corners, presumably struggling compared to everyone else, really. Because your car's just not got the straight line speed or the ability in the high speed that the other cars do.
Yeah, sometimes you feel like a GD2 with the FXR. It's on the straights, you have no chance. And that makes it hard if you have somebody who's laps down and you're trying to overtake them on the straight, they just regain their position at the end of the straight. They just draft you and they're gone.
Yeah, so I guess really, in your eyes, having the clean air that you have at the moment from other cars in class is very much useful, because you're going to function best when you're in clean air and they're in clean air, really.
Yes, I mean, the guys have practically been, I don't know, what time is it? How many hours have you been running now?
It's like, 10 hours in.
Yeah, they've been practically doing 10-hour qualifying runs. Everybody's been so, especially Nestor Ast, but also Andrew. And that was really because of the safety cars, clean air, and in between also. It was just the first 2 hours where Nestor Ast gained like a hell of positions, probably 6 or 7. 8, not sure. And then it was just bam, bam, bam. And he can go faster. He actually did a way better time on the pre-qual server doing a full stint than he did on the actual qualification.
You know, sometimes you do see that, where the track lends itself to when you've got the cooler, thin tyres on the car, you end up going quicker than you can do in quali.
I'm wondering what tyres the others are on. I think you might be the only car with R2, R3s.
Yeah, the R3, R2 is only on yourself. I've not looked at the other FXRs, which is a worthwhile point.
That's R3, R4, I believe. Judging by the length of the stints.
Yeah. Your tactics are obviously working with the tyres, because you've managed to eke as much pace as you can out of the car. I mean, yeah, the other FXRs are R3, R4, but several miles away from you guys. And then the FX, the FZRs and the XRRs all running R3, R3, which is the only way they can really get any pace and or distance out of their stints.
Yeah, it's been a different approach this time. Usually we try to compensate for the fact that the FXR is slower than the others by doing longer stints, thus doing less pit stops at the end of the race. Well, let's say in 24 hours try to do as less pit stops as possible. But this time, you know, we've had five drivers. I'm the sixth, and all five are on a similar pace and very quick. I'm the sixth one, and I'm not really quick, but anyways. And so we thought, you know, this might work, and indeed it did, until now.
Yeah, like you said, you got lucky with the safety car, but you weren't in a bad position before the safety cars.
No, absolutely not. No, I think we were like second or third.
Yeah, you were top three, even after the first couple of hours that I was originally here for. So, I mean, obviously, safety cars played in your favour, but you weren't exactly out of the running prior to that point anyway. You've just given yourself a nice bit of breathing space.
You know, so many times in the past we've seen teams like TDRT who were really fast with the FXR doing just as small stints as possible with as much pace as possible, and we always wanted to have a go at that as well, but it was never the right time, and this time it seems to be the right one.
It's worked for you so far, and I mean, 7th overall can't be bad when you look at the caliber of drivers you've got in front of you, who are in cars that are just quicker around this track. I mean, no one could have called that an FXR would be in the position that it is right now at any point during this race.
Yeah, really glad everybody's excited, and we're looking forward to the rest of the race. I think we're going to have some fun.
I hope so. I'm hoping for you that you carry on having the luck that you have at the moment, keeping the pace as well, because there's very few cars that have sort of had that mistake-free run so far.
Yeah, and
that's
why...
nothing's really gone horribly wrong, but you're one of the cars that hasn't had anything go horribly wrong.
That's why I just asked the other guys if possible not to have a go this time, because I'm roughly 1 second or more off the pace of the others, and I'll probably just flip the car.
But you've got a whole lap that you can throw away, so that's fine.
Yeah, I'd have a lot of margin, but still, I think it's best when, you know, they're all on the same pace, they've been doing very well. Why would we change that? If everybody's running 15s and I join the server and I run 17s, that's just, you know.
No, you're right. I mean, that's a logical decision if you want to hold station, which, when you're running first in class, you of course want to do.
And that also means that I get the time to talk to you guys, because the others are, you know, technically the first two guys now finished. Well, they're part of the game. They'll get some rest now, I believe, and maybe they'll come back in the morning for a strong finish. And while the others race, so I'll have to stay there and make sure to do as much as I can in terms of micromanagement, checking the IRC, checking the race control, and all that.
It sounds like we never really hear the voices of Hellenic Racing Team. You just turn up to the GT races and do very well for an FXR. It seems to be how you're known, a group of Greek drivers who drive an FXR particularly well.
Well, you know, Hellenic Racing Team is just a bunch of guys that enjoy motorsports and online racing, ranging from roughly 18 to roughly, I don't know, 45, 50-ish in years. And most of these guys are very humble, and they don't like to, they don't like the jibber-jabber in the IRC and in the forums, you know, they like to keep it low. That's except for me, though.
We need someone to interact with the forums just so you can sign up for the races, eh?
Well, yeah, they do that, yes, but you won't see much from us on the forums except for confirming the drivers and maybe asking a question, but that's it. Actually, I don't think we really ever have the time to do that. You know, we're so busy. Right now, the guys have on Google Drive, they have an Excel form where they fill in all the data we have from our stints, so we know how much time is left and all that. And it's a lot of work, so it keeps us busy.
Indeed. Just whilst you've been talking there, the car that was just up ahead of you on track, not for position, but a car that you were coming to lap, Core Racing Pro number 1, have gone and timed out and joined straight back in again. It looked like it may have just been a quick reset for Gunderman, almost, of his router, an involuntary reset, but he's back in and back underway. So, what really are your plans for the following 14 hours of competition here at Kyoto Long?
Well, I mean, if everything goes as planned, as mentioned, I'm not going to be racing, so the pace is going to stay like this, and hopefully at the end we'll be on the podium, on top of the podium, let's say, in the M-Class. It would be the first time we've had a third place finish in a 16-hour race somewhere in GT2. I'm not sure what kind of event it was. And so this will be our first endurance win, and we like online racing and we love endurance racing, so it would be a good thing.
Indeed it would. I've actually been, like, your FXR has obviously come up a lot today because it's outperforming where we're expecting FXRs to run here. And I was looking at your results for this series, and you didn't score any points in round one. And then, am I right in thinking that it's been a fourth and a fifth for the other two rounds?
I'm not sure. I'll have to check up on that. The first round didn't go well and ended in the first lap. And that's a pity because...
And you're off. Kalderakis has just had a moment, a rare moment, and lost the rear end there through turn 4.
Yeah, I think I saw it on the remote, but
back
in the
way, no harm there. But yeah, you look like you're in fairly good stead now to be doing well for the rest of the race. So, hopefully that will continue to be the case. Are you guys planning to make your presence known in any other leagues in Live for Speed or any other sim for that matter for the rest of the year?
Deco's gonna hate you for that question.
Most probably.
We've been considering iRacing for quite some time now. Some of the guys have been racing it on their own. I joined, I think I was the latest to join to iRacing. I really like it, but it doesn't have any driver swaps yet. If it does, it's very likely we will be endurance racing in iRacing, because it's just, for me, I'm not even going to compare them, LFS and iRacing. LFS is awesome and cost me, I don't know, 40 euros 6 years ago, and I've run so many nice races with it, but iRacing is just in a different league in all ways, and if driver swaps come into iRacing soon, and we're able to run Le Mans 24 hours or Spa 24 hours, something like that, we're there. we're not going to say goodbye to LFS completely, because right now it's the only the only option you have if you want to have a nice race like this one. And we're lucky there's people like you guys that keep hosting these things, because let's be honest, if nobody was hosting these events, it would be just, I don't know, drift servers and cruise servers on Elephas.
Yeah, well, two things that no one really wants to boast about openly. But it's always good, and another thing is the sim racing community, regardless of what sim you're using, is still very small, and I guess from my point of view it's important that teams do try and branch out into more than one sim, just to support the community as much as possible. Like, I've never wanted to limit myself to just racing on one simulator at any point. I always like to drive a bit of everything.
I guess that's a point of personal view. I haven't really... I like Netcar Pro, and I mean, R-Factor is alright as well, but I don't think anything comes close, or did come close to LFS in terms of the actual feeling of it and the leagues and stuff that is running. So why would you bother as a team to compete in anything else other than LFS? You know, we had the great pleasure and honor to be in Masters of Endurance, which was just a blast. And of course, I mean, everybody tries out things. I know some guys on the team that are eager for, what is it, Assetto Corsa?
Yeah, me, I'm not on your team, but me included.
I'd like to see what he comes up with. I believe there's a tech demo going on, or about to be released. Because, you know, the things that he's posting on his website are all great. License for BMW, license here, license there, but that's all just bragging now, isn't it? We haven't seen anything yet.
Yeah, licenses don't mean very much if it drives like Need for Speed.
Some people are also talking about project cars, but from what I've seen, it looks more like an arcade racer.
It shifts to with a supposed sim background. I'm with you on that. I don't really see any promise in it as such.
I think things are looking bright for endurance racing if iRacing really plans to get to driver swaps sometime soon. It's sad to see the LFS community kind of, you know, going apart and all that. Hopefully sometime we will see progress or development in LFS. The only development I see right now is just people creating in-sim apps like the one you're using for the race today, which is pretty neat. I don't know who did that one with the pit exit and stuff like that.
I believe that you've got people like Michael Booth and Timo Hinnan and Jonathan Palmer. They all put into the current in-sim that's used in this series, but like you say, LFS actually, for a game that's not technically a game that's moddable in the sense that R-Factor is moddable, you have so many plugins and various different ways to change the game, and now with the open configs as well being a nice positive addition, LFS is a game that in terms of how games work shouldn't have any life left in it, but the community, no matter how small, does keep giving LFS reasons to carry on existing in a competitive format like it is doing here.
Yeah, again, I mean, without these people doing those modifications, let's say, as well as the people running the leagues and events, LFS would just be a thing from the past. I think nobody would really care about it by now, but all these things keep LFS going. But the thing is that all those modifications you have to do, the community has to do for LFS, are already implemented in iRacing. Like, you don't need a tracker. If somebody drops during a race and he just connects again, he keeps his laps. So, problem solved. And the list goes on and on. I don't want to brag about it. I don't want to be talking about iRacing. Dick was going to hate me.
You'll probably get a few LFS fans on your back about it. But again, another thing with sims is, as much as we call them simulators, they're games. And people have preferences based on as many subjective points as there are objective pointers about it. I mean, some people will like iRacing because it's got licensed products, whereas others will like Live for Speed unconditionally because it has the live tire model functioning as well as it does. Yeah, everyone has their reasons, and they're not always valid or necessarily invalid. But I think the more people just try different sims and just enjoy the hobby as much as they can, the better they will do for the community in sim racing, and the better sim racing will end up doing for itself.
And you know, it's also a matter of price. You can't argue with somebody saying that iRacing is expensive, because it really is.
Yeah.
You'd have not only the membership, but just buying the tracks and the cars. But if you really do that and you buy the road content, you just realize how good it is. All the tracks and the cars. I don't really care about the licenses for the cars. I don't care if it's a Lada or a McLaren. I care about the tracks. It's nice to have the tracks that you see on television every day, driving them. That's awesome. But it's more of the overall package that really amazes me. That everything is way, like the statistics and everything. You can just, you click on somebody and you can immediately see, what was this PB on this? You can take the replay and go back in time. Like, somebody hits you during a race, you're in the pits and waiting for your car to be fixed. You can step out of the car and go back and see the incident as it happened. You don't have to save a replay or anything like that. And that would make the things we like or we love, endurance racing, so much easier.
Sure. Right. Just going to cut you off briefly. You're welcome to stay and continue discussing sim racing should you want. We just need to make a short break in the stream now so that we cut it up into those aforementioned lovely bite-sized chunks. We'll be right back with you once the ever-informant Jonathan Palmer has...